Welcome, everybody. This is Steve Hill with New Hydrogen, and I'm privileged to be here today with Dr. Tim Lewin, and I'll go over his credentials right now. Dr. Tim Lewin is a Regents Professor, the David S. Lewis Jr. Professor and Executive Director of the Strategic Energy Institute of Georgia Tech. He's also the founder and CTO of Turbine Logic, an analytics firm working in the energy industry. Professor Lewin is an international authority on clean energy and propulsion, and his work has contributed to numerous commercialized innovations in the energy and aerospace sectors. He's authored 4 books and over 400 publications. Dr. Lewin is an elected member of the National Academy of Engineering, a fellow of ASME, APS, and AIAA, and a foreign fellow of the Indian National Academy of Engineering. Major awards include the ASME-R Tom Sawyer Award, AIAA Pendray Award, and ASME's George Westinghouse Gold Medal. He received his PhD in mechanical engineering from Georgia Tech. And that's probably just getting started. Tim, welcome to the program and thanks for being with us.
Yeah, thanks, Steve. Glad to be here.
Glad you could join us. It's been a little while, you and I trying to get connected, and it's going to be a valuable conversation, I think, given your breadth of experience. I'd like to start out just a little bit, having you help us understand a little bit about gas turbine combustion systems. What are they? What are they used for, and how does hydrogen tie into those?
Yeah, it's a good question. So, I mean, if you think about it, you can think about gas turbines are just a means for converting the energy of fuel into something useful. It could be electric power, or it could be shaft power for a compressor, or it could be thrust for an aircraft engine. So essentially, any kind of airplane that you would fly that's not, you know, a prop type airplane is going to have a gas turbine. Many large compressors that move things around or power ships are powered by gas turbines. And then the largest source of electric power in the United States comes from gas turbines. And gas turbines are essentially, like I said, you have a jet engine where you pull air in, you compress it, you add fuel, it burns, it expands through the turbine. The gas turbine is totally agnostic as to what that fuel is. That fuel could be a fossil fuel. It could be like a Jet A for an aircraft engine or natural gas for electric power, or it could be a completely renewable fuel that has zero climate impacts, like hydrogen or a sustainable aviation fuel.
And so how does this work, though? Like, maybe you can walk people through the process of how does that generate electricity? How does gas use a turbine to create electricity
energy? So the way it works is that, you know, it's essentially when you got a fuel, you've got energy in the fuel and you're trying to convert it into electricity in this case. And so what you do is as that fuel burns, it expands as it goes through what's called the turbine. It spins the turbine, and that turbine is connected to a generator, and that spinning generator makes electricity. And so one of the key ideas for a hydrogen economy is hydrogen, you know, if you make green hydrogen from some renewable source, but you need a way to store that energy, you know, if it's let's say a wind farm or a solar plant. Well, one way to store the energy is with a bank of batteries. You know, one of the challenges there is those only last for, let's say, a day or two. Whereas if you can make hydrogen, maybe put it in a cavern underneath the ground, which is what they're doing in Utah as we speak with the Intermountain Project, you can store it as long as you need it. And then when you're ready for it, you can pull it back out and you can run it through the gas turbine. The reason for the gas turbine is they're just very, very efficient means of converting energy into useful work. And that useful work in this case would be electricity.
It's a fascinating area, and it really hasn't changed much in the recent past, has it? Or is this a technology that's evolving?
Yeah, so gas turbines are, it's a fun area where, you know, the same, it goes back to the 40s or maybe even the late 30s, the basic idea. But if you look at what there has happened with gas turbines is their efficiency, which is if you've got a given amount of energy in a fuel, how much of that gets converted into useful electricity and how much of that just gets shot out the back end of the engine as heat, and that's ultimately wasted. And so that efficiency is steadily rising year over year over year. You know, I've been in this business for about 25 years, and the efficiency has risen significantly just over the last 25 years, and it continues to rise as we. But the challenges are moving around. You know, once you address a given technical challenge, you run into some other technical challenges. So it's a really intellectually rewarding problem to work on, but it's also, these things are super high tech. You know, the, if you think a Lamborghini is a cool car and it's got a neat engine in it, you know, a modern gas turbine is a very sporty device in terms of how much power you get out of it for a given footprint or for its weight or for its cost. They're just super interesting, super cool.
Yeah. And speaking of technology, I mean, you're kind of got your hands in all kinds of technology. Are you seeing anything in the hydrogen world, kind of cool technology that's up and coming?
Well, I think so. Well, there's a couple pieces. You know, I think there's hydrogen production. You know, that's where we are today is we've got to drive down the cost of hydrogen production. So all eyes are on electrolyzers, you know, basically being able to make make hydrogen from green energy, you know, wind or solar. But, you know, there's also some other ideas, some really interesting ideas using something called pyrolysis, which is, it's a little bit of an old fashioned technology with a new twist, which is that essentially imagine you take a fossil fuel like a natural gas. A natural gas is basically carbon and hydrogen atoms. Imagine that you could take that carbon and rather than having it be carbon dioxide, which is a gas and it's kind of a pain to grab it and to store it, imagine you could just turn into graphite. And so now you've got natural gas. And so you have graphite, basically a pile of graphite, and you can make automobile tires or just put it in a pile. And then you've got pure hydrogen. And so that's kind of a really cool technology too, because if you think about it, we've got this huge natural gas infrastructure in the US, you know, millions of miles of pipeline, lots of homes are plumbed in for natural gas. Imagine you could just have a little converter right at your home or the plant that would take that, you know, it's coming in as natural gas. Then you get this pile of graphite and you get hydrogen to fuel your stove or your furnace or your generator.
And the benefit of that, of course, is using existing infrastructure. Looking at infrastructure in the future, that will be definitely one of the challenges we look at in storage, transportation of hydrogen. As hydrogen becomes more and more readily available, we're working on creating the world's cheapest green hydrogen and new hydrogen, but we will still need to figure out how to get it places, right? It's got to go places.
Yeah, exactly.
And so that transportation part of it is something that's existing right now that works good for natural gas. And we're hoping that transition happens over time because, of course, natural gas still is a limited resource. And graphite, while great, we still need to figure out what to do with that graphite. There's lots of interesting use for it, for sure.
And just to add, I mean, you mentioned transport. Transport's a really interesting issue for hydrogen as well. You know, lots of work going on in storage of hydrogen. Do we store it cryogenically? So do we make it super cold so it becomes a liquid? A little bit like if you ever watched the space shuttle take off and that big orange thing in front of the space shuttle, that was liquid hydrogen, lots of it. That's one way to do it. Or do you compress it to a high pressure to store it? How do you move it around? So there's a lot of innovation going around in just storage. And once you produce it, you know, how do you move it and how do you store it? A lot of interesting things going on there as well.
Yeah, you know, we're talking about technology in terms of like the hardware, but what about like and you have this experience with Turbine Logic, what about data and analytics? How can this help move things forward?
Yeah, so I think ultimately, you know, if you think about a hydrogen economy, you know, you're going to be talking about sources of energy, which might be, you know, green energy like solar and PV. You're going to be thinking about users. Those could be large and centralized facilities. Those could be more distributed residential facilities. And so just like data and analytics is really important for realizing, let's say, virtual power plants, you know, kind of these grids of the future where you're matching supply and demand and things like that. In the same way, if you think about hydrogen as a network where you've got a whole set of producers and transportation and consumers, and those consumers could be transport. By transportation, I meant transportation of hydrogen, but then also then the users of hydrogen, which could be using it to make electricity or to transport a car or, but they're just, information, knowledge, analytics are really, really important for optimizing those systems and balancing supply and demand.
Yeah, and so it's kind of a two-part factor. I hadn't really thought much about that side of things, right? We're working so hard on the mechanical side of it, like the actual production of hydrogen. I think it's super important to also consider this sort of analytics. How can we optimize and how can we find better ways to make it happen? Maybe one final question for you as we're kind of burning through time here, but I wanted to know kind of what your outlook is for the future of this hydrogen economy. What kind of barriers do you see that we're facing moving forward? What kind of positive things do you see? Give us your outlook.
Yeah, so I think, I guess I would have two barriers that I would highlight. One would be, you know, we sort of have a chicken and egg situation where there's just not a lot of, you know, let's say gas turbines is my own background. And you know, people have been working for decades on making gas turbines hydrogen capable, but they're really, I mean, other than maybe some blast furnaces and Japan or some refinery off gas in Houston, Texas, there just simply isn't that much hydrogen supply out there. And so there hasn't been, you know, the need to get this technology out there. And so this chicken and egg between supply and demand, and, you know, that's really what the U.S. Department of Energy is trying to solve with the hydrogen hubs, is trying to get a massive amount of hydrogen production in play. So then you start seeing those utilization use cases come to the fore. So I think just solving that chicken and egg problem is one challenge. I think the other challenge, though, just to be very, very frank, is, I mean, as long as natural gas costs $2.50 or $3 per million BTU, that's a significant headwind for anything else. You know, and I mean, I would just give you an example. You know, the DOE has their their hydrogen shot, which has the goal of getting hydrogen to $1 a kilogram. But if you're using, obviously there's lots of uses for hydrogen. You can use it as a feedstock to make a chemical. You can use it for transport. You can use it for a fuel. But if you're going to use hydrogen as a fuel, $1 per kilogram translates to somewhere between $8 and $9 per million BTU. And so as long as natural gas is $2.50, that's a big delta in price. And so just the general cost of hydrogen and the utilization of hydrogen without a carbon tax to have fossil fuel sources be essentially paying for the cost of the societal cost of the CO2 that they're putting into the environment.
Yeah, there's a couple of levers that have to be pulled in order for that momentum to get moving. As we pick the chicken or we pick the egg, whichever way we want to push,
yeah,
we've got to have those levers pulled so that the momentum can continue to build. So what about on that positive side?
Well, I mean, I think the hydrogen hubs are really exciting. And, you know, what's really, I think, obviously, on the negative side is the Southeast, which is where I am. We did not get selected for a hydrogen hub, which is super disappointing. But on the other hand, there's a lot of really interesting hubs. They have lots of different use cases, different production means, different, again, utilization sources. And so, you know, we're going to be running, 7 large scale, you know, billion-dollar experiments moving forward over the next decade. Can be really exciting to see those move forward. And again, try to address this chicken and egg problem.
Yeah. And despite what everybody, despite what might be happening in the market temporarily, any hiccups we may have, I mean, Goldman Sachs predicts this to be a $12 trillion market by 2050. We're seeing major investments from our government, and that's leading to a cascading effect globally. And so the money is there for the innovation to begin really accelerating. And hopefully Moore's Law takes effect here, right? And we see the doubling of efforts and doubling of technology as each year goes by. We're certainly working hard on that. Did you have any, it's been so awesome talking with you. 20 minutes goes by super fast with you. I'm wondering, is there anything else you wanted to kind of, any parting shots, any last thoughts on this hydrogen economy or anything that you're working on?
No, I mean, I'm really excited about the hydrogen economy. I think it solves a lot of problems in terms of how do we get from where we are today to a net zero economy. And so there's just, you know, the ability to gradually transition and use natural gas as a bridge fuel, to displace it with hydrogen, to use hydrogen as a transport fuel, to use hydrogen as a feedstock to replace fossil fuels for chemicals. You know, there's just a lot of really interesting and very, very different use cases. It's going to be fun to watch all these large scale pilots play out and see, you know, kind of some of the first commercial use cases. But yeah, it's an exciting time to be working in energy and hydrogen.
Yeah, you couldn't have picked a more exciting place to be, actually, in my opinion. So good on you for being there. And thanks for joining us. If anybody watching wants to learn about how New Hydrogen is tackling this problem, visit us at newhydrogen.com. And again, Dr. Tim Lewin from Georgia Tech, thank you for joining us today.
Yeah, happy to be here. Take care.
You too.